the traditional dance was part of his environment. And the other happy coincidence is that he knew a man called Oscar Kohlberg, which of course we never heard of, but which we would call today an ethnomusicologist. He lived much longer than Chopin, and he collected 22,000 folk dances in Poland. And when they were students, he already started at 16 collecting them, and Chopin had access to these peasant dances, so he could, it inspired him. He had these themes, he had the rhythms, and all of that. So already musicologist in 1820. Well, the important thing to remember in these mazurkas is that he never tried to be authentic the way Bartok was. Chopin never quoted, or maybe once or twice, a real peasant mazurka. Everything was just atmosphere. It was just the flavor, the feeling of the mazurka. It's completely original. There's not the quotation. He only published 43 mazurkas in his lifetime. Now they're digging up, we only record about 60 of them, but he only wanted 43 published. Like, as you know, he only wanted 8 waltzes published, but everybody plays 21 because they're so good, even the ones that he hated. Most of them were composed after he left Poland. They were written mostly in France. And notice that there's always a melancholy about them. I imagine it's nostalgia for Poland. The point to remember is that what we call the mazurka is not, it's not a mazurka, there's no such thing. It's really a combination, it's called of three dances. The first one is the oberek, around the Slovak border in the mountains. It's a dance where you just play instruments. There's no voices, only instruments. It's a fast dance. It's in 3/8, not 3/4. And it's the kind of thing that we associate a mazurka with. The cavalier spins the lady, they're stamping the feet. It's sort of like, that's the thing he wrote most, Chopin. It comes from where he lived. It's a thing, I'm sorry, I forgot to say, the oberek always is in major, always. The mazur can be in major and minor, it can be sung, or played, or both. The tempo is not fast, it's sort of moderate. The accent is always on the third or second beat. And we'll see later when I give the examples. Usually the important modulation in Chopin is not falls on a different harmony, but that's a subtlety I can show later. Let's see, some mazurkas are typically from the German border of Poland. It's always sung and always slow. So the accents, also there are accents on the third beat, but in Chopin usually it's just interesting modulations, interesting melodic curves on these weak beats. You know, Kubiak is they think a mazurka is a mazurka, and somebody told them you have to wait on the third beat and you have to make an accent here and you have to do that. So whether they play an oberek, a kujawiak, or a mazur, it sounds almost the same. And then even a kujawiak, which has hardly any accents. It's just very smooth and sunny. In the Chopin contest where the jury, you know, the foreign students will make an accent, and I say, why did you do that? Because that's the tradition of the mazurka, and Chopin didn't write any accents. So I almost prefer that they just play it like Mozart, and to try to make a mazurka out of a kujovjak, or an oberek out of a mazurka, or a kujovjak out of an oberek, you know. It's become just one big blended soup, you know. Now, what's amazing with Chopin is that I try to reduce the motives, and in basic, there's only one, in these 80 pieces, there's one basic rhythmic motive, and it's what's the miracle is that he makes music out of a rhythmic motive, which is just simply this, or dum, or da-da-da-dum, that's it. 80 pieces, for example, you see, and it's typical of Chopin's character, and you see that in later pieces, in the ballades and scherzos. He uses a repeated motive, but he has a special, you know, he goes around his suffering and self-torturing all the time. It's amusing, this is where the harmonist Chopin is amazing. For example, you have a motive like this. In one mazurka, I'm not joking, and it goes again. We have this like this, you know, 16 times. So you think either the pianist is stupid or the composer is stupid. But when you add the harmony, show the way to change the color of the 16 times of the motive is the harmony. What's interesting is the fifth going up, you know. You see, and then, which gives that sort of archaic. And then diatonic. So I mean, when you see the first, even the fourth ballade, if you think the introduction, Twinkle Little Star. So that's his genius. It's not. It's to take two measure motives and to make an enormous tapestry. Now, also, in terms of interpretation, we have a problem. As I said, people tend to put it in a mold. They put a gotcha, they wait before the second beat, the third beat. And there is a problem. For example, as a rule of thumb, as the Americans say, in these motives, ta-ta-tam-pam, the accent is on the second beat when the harmony doesn't change. Second, you see the harmony is still in the same tonic. It's on with the same motive, dum ba dum ba. When the harmony changes, it's on the third beat. This way too. How silly it would be, or if you did. So the harmony determines everything here. And it's also a problem of interpretation, because there's a funny story when Chopin was teaching a mazurka to a pupil in a Paris apartment, Meyerbeer, the composer, you know, Barbara, came in and said, you know, what's that piece in 4-4? And Chopin said, it's a mazurka and it's in 3-4. And Meyerbeer says, no, it's 4-4. And Chopin said, no, it's in 3. And they started arguing, and it was this one. Did such a Nagajic accent on the third beat, or maybe the... Yeah, that's what he did. He waited so long on the first beat. But I still don't see how he could get 4 out of that, you know? So it must have been quite exaggerated, and then Chopin walked out of the room, and Meyerbeer told the pupil, don't listen to him, he has absolutely no rhythm. But that's a problem of interpretation. We'll get into the modes. Chopin used these old church modes, and he basically used Lydian and Phrygian modes. The Lydian is the one he used all the time. It's extremely far-reaching implications. You'll see later when we do Mazurka by Mazurka for this chromatic modulations. As you know, the Lydian scale in it's the fourth degree sharp. You see, so or in minor. Instead of in F major, instead of that sort of thing. That's the Lydian. And he uses it as an expressive device later. I'll just quickly go over the Phrygian mode as this one. Phrygian mode, Lydian mode, and he often puts the Lydian F sharp back to the tonal. So you have and just that that he found in Zakopane in the mountains. The peasants sang. I was getting back there. Now, what Chopin did was, he realized that it was this. So you notice you have this motive. And then the same one. And I also reduced it as far as I could, and that's the motive that you find in all mazurkas. And in diatonic sequences. There, in that sense, he
this is important. Just keep that in mind when we do Mazurka by Mazurka. Because, you see, when he does it into a chromatic sequence, interesting is in the very first Mazurka, Opus 6, which he wrote, I don't know, about 18 or 19 years old, you already have it, you see. He has, in the F-sharp minor scale, the Lydian is this. This is what Liszt and Wagner and all these people in the late 1800s used. This division of the octave, we'll get into that later. It's this four that was. See, it goes all the way to Debussy. It's a suspension of tonality, which finally, in a funny way, just, I think, arrived from the peasants. Now, we'll do several examples to make things clearer. One of the set, number four of opus 63, number three of opus 63, number four of opus 30, number three of, they're always called, they were called Mazurkas poems, because they're much more expanded. They're, you know, four, five, six pages. They're interesting in the sense that he mixes all the dances up in them. He has an operek, he has a kujavyak, he has a mazur. And that's why they're so special, the mazurkas, for many of us. It's because, in a very short form, because he has these three rustic dances that are completely different, he expresses enormous amount of emotion in a very short space of time. Like the last mazurka lasts a minute and a half, and it's like a whole symphony. So. But the point is to find out where the dance changes. Okay, now this funny thing is in A minor. So you see, A minor, he uses the Lydian. And the Lydian going back to the normal, to the D. So look, the codas are very expressive. Classically, always gets back to the tonic. But what's amazing is that already as a teenager, he was aware of this exploration. Debussy wrote that it's amazing that we have to work, and Chopin found the things we had to analyze for years. I'm just going to go a bit in depth. It was 24 number 4. It's one of these first very long mazurkas. And it's a very interesting piece because it's quite dissonant. Quite, for us, it's nothing. And Rellstab, a Berlin critic, when Chopin played it to him, he said, "This is terrible music. Chopin betrays his vulgar Slavic roots with this music." So what do you think about us? And when you see what betrays his vulgar Slavic roots, I'll show you, it's funny. Anyway, the beginning, I remember playing it once at Harvard, and a student of Schoenberg said, that's more modern than the Ravel Gaspar that you played, because it's 12 tone, you know. So he uses all the 12 tones before he gets to the tonic. And here, let's go in precision more. You see he uses the Lydian scale, the bottom voice. He's doing this. Instead of doing this, he's doing that. And you see, when you get there, he wants it particularly expressive. Harmony change. Now the Lydian. It's really wanted, that E sharp. Here we starts with the mazurka, then the middle section, he gets into a kujovjak, you see. And then back to the mazurka. Another change. He incorporates the Lydian E. You see, he uses the ambivalence of a seventh and a German sixth. You see, he goes into a different F major. In another mazurka, he does the opposite, but the one that goes... subtle way, but you have to be aware that E is important. And for example, this whole section. What happens, as you see, the Lydian is a tritone from the tonic, and you can imagine all that harmony, the tonal implications of that as far as you can get. So, look what happens in the middle section. this is fascinating because it comes from these very simple origins of folklore. The same in the first ballade. You see how far he is. Again, the Lydian from the. It's in B flat here, and it's in E major there. And he's always playing with these. Again, once again, the codas in this one. This is the first one of the, with the long coda, which is the where he makes the coda goes like this. Very clearly the three dances. You see, it's again, notice again. You see that phrase. You find that all of it. You'll find this half note plus a major third hidden in almost all the passage work and many other pieces too. Okay, so you see the piece starts with the Huyuyak, and it's a perfect example of what the French critics said that was wonderful, that in this short period of time he could just change mood. You see, you to the he ends. Starts getting very interesting. You see, if you just take the modulations, they're almost Wagner. This goes up. But he's doing it this way. It's just a chromatic scale. And notice that the short motives. They fit very well into this idea of modulation, of chromatic modulation. Look the way he gets around it. Probably Wagner would probably go directly, or this maybe. Chopin does it by putting in dominance. It's a mazurka to show those dominants. Notice where they're placed. They're placed on the third beat. Because if you don't show them, it becomes a chromatic scale. Today, musicologists they're approaching. There's what's called the Neo-Riemann school. Musical dualism, and they wanted to have a new harmony to explain Wagnerian harmony, because if you explain Wagnerian harmony the way you would explain a Mozart sonata, it would take about 1,000 pages to do Tristan. Somebody did it. These are sort of harmonic shortcuts. They had a completely different way of looking at chromaticism. Chopin was still in the old school, but he was already looking ahead. We'll see that in the last mazurka. This obviously, these additions, they put the last ones in the scoop. Oh, here it is. This one.
first mazurka. He's fascinating. Oh, the same thing here, you see. It's this, what they call minimal, this is how they explained Wagnerian transpositions quickly. And now they're making a study into it because they're interested in the 19th century. You see, it's called minimal voice leading. In other words, look what he's doing. You see, he's just going, moving one voice. Two voices. To explain if from a tonal point of view, so they're explaining it from a chromatical point of view. In this piece, for example, look what happens. Remember in Wagner you have the Tristan. Look at the end of here. He modulates here. Now imagine in the classical way, from F minor to get into A major. So I don't know how many fifths do you have to go down. You have to go down. Steps of modulation. Look what Chopin does. He takes the F minor chord, he moves it up a step, he moves it down a half step, and then he moves the middle voice up a half a step. You see, it's a shortcut. Instead of going through all of that, you see. Even today they analyze Chopin's music and late Romantic music by the classical way. So this is the dominant of the dominant of the dominant, you know. But these very small pages, these measures make even people like Boulez consider him a great revolutionary and innovator. And for me it was interesting that it's all of this really new stuff is mostly in these little mazurkas, which in a funny way started from simple peasant dances. Now, just to finish, just a statement from Chopin, just before his death, he admitted that that's what he liked most, that it was his musical diary, the mazurka, because it brought him back to Poland. And it's quite sad. He said, when he was dying, when he wrote this last mazurka, he said, "Now I've said all I could say. Moreover, I don't even know how one sings in my country anymore." You see, the idea is that they're all just in his mind, in his fantasy, it's not a concrete thing anymore. And then he died. But on the other hand, for us, mazurka is cinnamon, Chopin's music. That's it. Thank you.
Play the one analyzer. things that you can't talk.
You can't analyze every note and say this is the double dominant of the tonic. Who cares? Finally, who cares? This is a complete waste of time for you. Just play.